precise number. What we are talking about today is, you see it on the screen, it's smoke and fire. That was the lecture. The lecture is architect meets safety. The place where architect meets safety, you see here in the smoke, nothing, so you cannot meet it. And that's why we are talking about that. And I will come to introduce you some basics which we are confronted with as we are dealing in this smoke and fire curtain business for a long time now. Some calculation methods which we are using to calculate the smoke-free areas and so on, and for sure a lot of samples. And after the smoke curtains, we will come back, we will come also to fire curtains, which is quite different, but I will show it during this lecture. Exhausting systems, the norms for the basics. We are located in Germany and the European Community, we have tested and certificated our systems for the EN norms. We have done up to now no testing or certificating for UL, as the market for UL systems for us was not so interesting. And for sure, testing for UL will account a lot of money. We are talking about a six-digit number, which we should invest for only for testing. Some components of our systems are UL recognized, but they are not UL listed. This is very important, as far as I know, that in Israel, sometimes UL listing is also required. I want to show the exhausting systems and norms. We in Europe, the EN12101 is specification for smoke barriers. Smoke barriers is not only textile, it's also can also be made of aluminium. The 12101 part 2 is specification for ventilations. That means for openings, for flowing the air away from out of a building. The 12101 part 3 is the specification for the mechanical smoke ventilators. That means which are motor driven and not natural driven. The 12101 part 9 is for the controls, which is also very important. How should this system work? How should they work in the combination of a natural exhausting system, airflow, inlet, firefighters, what they could have an impact on it. And for sure, power supply. How should it be able to work also in case of emergency? How should we do the cabling, that it works still after a 100-minute fire and so on? And for sure, a lot of other, like local building regulations for countrywide and so on. The basic systems, what we are talking here, if you calculate for example, for an industrial building, is that we have smoke areas, which should be not bigger than 1,600 square meters. That is a number which comes out of a history that the firefighters can cover this area with one firefighter truck. Buildings which has bigger smoke areas than 1,600 square meters can be divided in different sections with smoke barriers. If you have special requirements inside of a building, you can also increase in according to the German and European norms, the smoke section up to 2,500 square meter. But therefore is required mandatory that the building height is higher than 7 meters and it should be classified BMG 345. BMG is a building classification, which I will explain later on when we come to the calculations. The smoke-free layer should be minimum 2 meter height. The reason therefore is people should pass below, cars should pass below. So, This is important because we have not a smoke closure, we have only a smoke barrier to canalize the smoke. The maximum length of a section should be not longer than 60 meters. This is also according to the firefighters, because the pipes we have, they can go for 60 meters. And therefore, one side of a building should be maximum 60 meters. So you ask now, how could we come to 2,500? 60 by 50 would be 3,000 square meters. So yeah, it's a huge number where we can go. The air inlet should not be in the smoke area, so it should be lower than 250. The inlet of the air is recommended to be placed lower of smoke layer free area than 50 centimeters up to 1 meter, that the fresh air which comes in will not create turbulences inside of a building. I come later on to that when I show you the schematic. The air inlet, the openings of the air inlet is also very important, should be one time of the opening of the exhausting area. That's the reason, therefore, is you have in the smoke gases got very hot, they expand in their volume, and to get them out of a building, you need more airflow, which is coming from outside in to lift it up to the exhausting systems, which is, you need an airflow when in the natural ventilation. And in each 200 square meter, one exhausting device must be placed. That could be a light dome, a small light dome, or an opening in the roof. You see here the schematic view of a natural exhausting system. We see here we have a fire, we have a development of a smoke. Smoke gases got very hot, so they go up to the exhausting systems. We have here people who can escape. We have here the smoke barrier, which divides this area in two sections. If we don't have it, the smoke will also spread to this area here. And so we will have a lot of damages also on this side. Coming back to the air inlet, which we are have talked about before. If this air inlet would be right in here, the smoke might block the fresh air coming in, it would go out here. And for sure, the fresh air will pull smoke down to the ground, which is not the reason, the sense behind smoke exhausting systems. So calculation method, it's the calculation assumes it's always for the design of a smoke exhausting system. Time from the start of a fire to a fire alarm, this is duration of a fire development. Normally, we assume that we take 10 minutes till it is detected. However, time can be reduced to 5 or maybe to 0 minutes in the presence of fire alarm systems, which is directly linked to firefighters or to building management, or if you have in your plant firefighters organization. The value depends on the installed system and the fire alarm types, for sure. In an average time of 10 minutes, normally we assume that all the system, that the fire is everywhere applied and it's communicated inside of a building. This time can be corrected, as I mentioned before, but this time can also be corrected to 15 minutes in case of unfavorable conditions, or to 20 minutes if, for example, it's a building outside in the area where no one is, no people are there, no workers are there, no one is, there's no link to the environment. Yes. This is, and when we got to a fire propagation velocity, that means what is fire development inside of a building. And therefore, if it's very slow, so we got, we have middle and we have high, and depending on the duration of a fire development, we got a building management class, an average design group called Bemessungs, in German, it's called Bemessungsgruppe BMG. And out of this scale, we got the BMG for the building, which we place in here in this scale, which is a number scale. So we have here the total room height, we have here the height smoke layer, and we have here the height smoke free layer. So in addition, the height smoke layer and the height smoke free layer must be this number. And according to this height smoke free layer, and the BMG, the average design group, we got a value directly in. For example, if we have 30 meter by 50 meter room with 1,500 square meters, we have a fire alarm time via smoke detector 5 minutes, extinguishing attack time standard 10 minutes, development that means 50 minutes. We got an out of the scale and average design group BMG 3. We have a height of 8 meters. We have an air inlet, which in this sample will be two gates. We have 3 meters with 4 meters. According to this 3 meters height from the air inlet, coming back to some sheets before, we have to go for a smoke-free layer of 3.5 meters because it should be, this gate opening should be lower than the smoke-free layer. And therefore we got an aerodynamic free area, which should be open in case of fire of 5 square meters. This is very simple, but it works. And we had a very, very good experience in that. So that we can gamble with that. If you say you have more, you want more free openings in the roof, for example, with daylight systems from Paragon and so on, you can say, okay, the height of a smoke-free layer must only be less than 3 meters. I'm a bit confused. the height of a smoke layer is should be lower when we can come to another opening space, and you don't need to place so much smoke curtains in the height. I hope it is clear. Otherwise, please come back later on with via Omri to me. Schematic view of a mechanical exhausting system, it is nearly the same. We have here a fire. You see my screen? I hope so. We have here a fire. We have here the smoke development, and we have here mechanical exhausting system over the roof. The other possibility is also that we have axial ventilators which collect and guide the smoke out to the side. That's very common in shopping centers, in underground garages and so on. They don't have the entrance directly to the roof. The design of the system is nearly the same. You have also the duration of a development, the fire development. You have the fire propagation velocity. You got the average design group. You take it out. You have a heat release rate. Heat release rate is the energy which will be developed during a fire in a building. There are a lot of assumptions how this could be calculated. It's separated normally in 300 kilowatts per square meter or 600 kilowatts per square meter. The difference comes more or less out of volume which you have to transport. And for sure, the temperature of the ventilator should stand, because if you have, for example, you see here we have a building, an average design group of 3, and we have the height of a smoke-free layer of 7 meters. So you have to throw away 180,000 cubic meters per hour. And if you calculate the air inlet you have to bring, that would be 1.5, so it's more than 250,000 cubic meters. So you have to secure that the openings, the air inlet for the exhausting system must be nearly 250,000 cubic meters. This causes also a lot of over and under pressure in the buildings, so in that in some situations, some doors might be blocked, some windows might be blocked, which can be in confrontation to a fire rescue system. The same is with scale designs where the power of a smoke exhausting ventilator, and this scale over here, describes the gas temperature of the smoke. That is very important for the smoke ventilator. Just described with this scale with a volume, which you have to calculate, how you can calculate. The reason for the difference between 300 kilowatt and 600 kilowatt, I just try to explain. There are no perfect data. It can be calculated perfectly if you collect all the things which are inside of a building. You count the energy load, the fire energy load, which is in these parts, and you add it together. And when you get a volume of heat power for per square meter. But normally, as I explained before, it's differentiated between 300 kilowatt per square meter and 600 kilowatt per square meter. And this is very, very important also for this scale here, where we have the smoke gas temperature, which is very important for ventilators, because if you have a ventilator which is normally dedicated to a surround temperature of 200 to 250 degree, you should not use it, for example, in this case, for an average design group, one by a smoke-free layer of 2 meters, if you assume that you have 600 kilowatt per square meter heat release rate. So that is also very important for your calculations for the systems. Okay. We have a classification of the smoke curtains, which are according to the EN12101, which I said before. We have always the glass, normally 600 degree. 600 degree is, coming back to the scale before, we have a maximum gas temperature of 555 degree. So the curtain must only stand to the 600 degree. And therefore, you got a classification. Should it take for 30 minutes? Should it take for 60 minutes, 90 minutes, 120, 180, 240? Normally, at the end, if you are 240 minutes, we are talking about 4 hours. If you are still need with curtains, then you have other problems on site. For special conditions, you can also have the classification for ETK. That means the curtains are tested for 1,100 degrees. But I can't withstand this material. It's very important. This criteria is the same as for fire curtains, but the criteria for the smoke curtain for DH is a bit higher, as the curtain is hanging in the air and not it's a closure completely on the ground. So the curtain has to carry also his own load, and also the load of the complete bottom profile, which is very high because it has to be stable. And we got also the classification for 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 90 minutes, and 120 minutes. So yeah, how does smoke curtains work? You see here, it's just quite simple. We have here on this area, smoke development, very strong. We have here a smoke curtain, which is just blocking the smoke to come to the other side of the area. We had a realistic test. We had to do it according to the requirements of firefighters at the airport in Zurich. And therefore, we had to bring, or not only we, also our customer, we had to bring some smoke machines, which are maybe used also in clubs and bars and so on, to develop the smoke. We have here the smoke mechanical smoke exhausting system. We have here a sprinkler head as well. And we have here a smoke exhausting system, a mechanical smoke exhausting system. And this one here is a smoke barrier, a flexible smoke barrier. And it works like that. In case of emergency, it releases. The smoke is spread, flows under the ceiling, is dedicated to the exhausting systems, and it cannot pass this smoke curtain because it's running down and blocking it. On the next picture, it's from the same test procedure. You see here, we have we can go for big widths. We have here the sign for emergency that people can pass below. We have here the smoke. And the difference from here to here is the height of the smoke curtain. This smoke curtain, as it is the same area, nearly the same area, same calculation base, doesn't have to be so high as we have here a skylight dome, which can be also used for smoke, for natural smoke exhausting in combination with this mechanical smoke exhausting systems. You see here, this is architecture. It's from the bottom, you see normally nothing, and you have got a complete exhausting system combined in my mind, beautiful design. Our smoke curtains are used very often in atriums. We have here an atrium, we close it completely down. We have here emergency ways behind, and we have also done smoke tests for that. We have here a curtain which you can pass through. This is important as in this scenario, all the handicapped people should be collected on the other side of the curtain if there's a fire. And the combination of these two systems, ones like that, you see here, we have here the complete curtain running down, and we have here also a curtain running down, but you see here, it's divided. And if we wait just a few seconds, we will see that people can pass through, and it's afterwards still closed again. So this is very often used if you have stairways where people might, you will see it afterwards in another sample as well. Just to let people pass through. Very often we place here as well a sign for emergency where people can pass, but in this case it was not necessary. Static smoke barriers for industrial buildings, you see it here, to create these smoke sections. You can make breakthroughs for pipes, for everything. You can adapt it, you can wrap it, you can wrap the installations inside of a building, the gridders, everything, and it's completely smoke tight. They are hanging here, just hanging around, and just blocking the smoke in case of emergency. And it's not a big load for a building, which is also very important, as you have a weight of smoke textile itself of roughly 500 grams per square meter. So you can also easily install it under static reasons to nearly each construction. We have here some other samples of flexible smoke barriers. This is IKEA shopping center. So we have to block the smoke spread from here to the next story. We have to also be aware of this roller stair. So it should be on this place more than 2.50 meters. You see here, it's running over 25 meters, made out of one piece. It's smoke tight. It's working pretty well, but at the end you will see a picture of the same situation, how it should not work. Here, to separate smoke curtains in a very, very huge hall where normally waste will be stored. So we have to go for a five meter height smoke barrier for a length of 150 meters. 150 meters cannot be done in one piece, as would have too much torque on the tube itself. Smoke curtains, fire curtains in this stage are normally always rolled up, held by a magnetic brake in the upper position, provided with 24 volts. And in case of emergency, always the brake is released. Curtain starts to run down. It rolls down again. It descends. And due the turning of itself, it creates a magnetic field which closes the brake again. So the curtain more or less stops. And as it stops, the magnetic field breaks together and the curtain starts to run again. So it's the decent average speed is roughly 15 centimeters per second, so that you have enough time to go away if you are directly below. And for sure, it will not come down like a guillotine and kill someone. In this area, we had a bank. We have a lot of public areas which should be separated at this was not to 1,600 square meters per smoke section. This was only to 900 square meters, as it was not conducted to the industrial rules. It was conducted to hotel rooms, people where people meet, where official requirements are. Sorry for my voice. Here we have a special solution for a very, very huge industrial hall. You see here, we have a crane track. The crane track opening is more or less 1 meter. And according to the fire concept, a leakage of this 1 meter was not allowed, otherwise smoke might go to the other side. Therefore, we had to add additional systems, which are normally placed here in this position and are released in case of emergency by cable and swing. You see here the combination, the connections to the subconstruction, swing below this crane track and release itself. Dimensions, you can see here, we have 12 meters. These are 12 meters. It's very, very huge. And we have 10 meters in width. To close with, these are very, very special constructions. But yes, we like to do that. Yes, it's quite a big effort for us. Now we come to office buildings. This is a high-rise building where we had to create a 50-story building. We have this staircase, which goes over a complete 15 stories. We have to separate it from the levels, from the floors behind by smoke and fire. And you see the shape. You cannot make rolled systems around an edge. You only have them straight. So we have to use another system, a folded system. It is fixed here and here, and for sure up in the other ceiling. You see here, it's quite simple. There's it's not a big issue to install them. And yes, just want to show you. This is the building. It's a building close to Stuttgart. You see here the 15 stories. And you see now the system which closes the stairway completely from the floors. Such a system was installed in each floor. It's a folded system where you can go over the edges. You are nearly unlimited in width. And you can close it completely. And it's separated. You can also use it not only as a smoke barrier, also as a fire barrier. We had done another solution with a very, very strange geometry. You see here, this is the geometry going this angle here. We have a roller stair, which in the beginning of a planning phase was not of interest to anyone. At the end, when we made the test, Well, before we made the test, we said, okay, if people are staying on the stairway and they are here and the emergency came, they want to run to the other system and not down. So we had to add a separate stripe coil, as we mentioned it before in the video. And you see here on the geometry, you see here the installation to the ceiling. And we have here the other system, the striped coil. You see it here where people can pass through, which is over the roller stairs. And you see here we have a tube inside, which is speared, but it will not make a bow. And we have here the textile running out. We need a weight, but it's running down by its own weight. This cannot be a steel profile. This must be something soft. So we use sand sacks. And I also had a video from the installation, and I hope, yes, it will run. You see the dimensions. You see that you see normally nothing in the normal situation. And in case of emergency, the systems are running down. You can see here that we go accurately to the edges, to the balustrades. So, and here you have this part of smoke curtain where you can pass through. This is very important because, as I mentioned before, if people are staying here and the alarm comes and everything around them gets closed, we don't want to run down, we just run in this direction, and therefore we should be able to pass. Another big issue is parking garages. It's not so clear this picture as I see, but we have here always smoke curtains which separates in different smoke sections. The difference in parking garages, in underground parking garages, is that you normally work always with mechanical exhausting systems. And as I noted before, you got a big over and under pressure. Therefore, you cannot take the smoke curtains without side guides. The smoke curtains should stand wind speeds of 10 to 50, up to 40 meters per second. And for sure, they should stand also the pressure of the curtains. You see, we have the ramps from one level to the other level. We have here some separating. We have here curtains. So we got a lot of curtains only on one level. This is the complete building area. The underground is completely below it. And you see here the drawings where we go for, we fix it here to the concrete on site. We have here the tube inside. The housing is 203 by 220, so it's not huge. For an opening, which is normally required of 2.10 centimeters in a parking garage, it's quite simple to install because normally you have a level height of 2.50 meters. And for sure, this is how it looks in reality. And you see, we have two curtains separating the upper level from the lower level. Here are three curtains. And they are always smoke tight. We had a soft stripe at the end of a bottom bar, but it closes completely and also closes very, very tight to the ground. Now, smoke curtains more or less are done. It's only a short overview. There are so many other solutions. There are so many other regulations, but I guess it's just for an overview. It's okay. Textile fire closures, we go for also for at the beginning for norms, what the expressions does mean. E-integrity is only that no fire comes from one side to the other side. EW increases this performance of a curtain, but it reduces also radiation which comes through the curtain. So you have here 1,100 degree, and you have here on the other side 15 kilowatt per square meter radiation heat. And EI, you have here, it's an insulating curtain. That means that you have on the surface only 140 Kelvin on the curtain on its side. For this, as this is very interesting for a lot of people, I just show you some pictures of tests. This is a test according EN34 for E120. So we have here our furnace, we have here our sample. We place some paper, some wood in different distances ahead. You see here it's 8:30. At 10:15, the curtain itself, it's glowing and glimmering. The heat is very, very high. At 11:15, it's still the same. And close to 11, we finished the test. But you see here in 150 distance, you still have the wood. You have some papers in 2 meter distance, which still are alive. Instead that you have here 1,100 degree in 2 meter distance. So the curtain itself works. This is the increased curtain, which is normally or very often coated with a special aluminium on the outside, which reflects the heat inside of the furnace itself, so that you get the radiation closer than 15 kilowatt in 1 meter distance, so you can pass. And this is a test picture for an EI curtain. You see during the test nearly nothing. You have here the specimen, the furnace behind. And after the test, before you have a thickness of a material of roughly 1 centimeter, and after the test, it has blown completely up to block the heat, but the heat will not come through. But we have a thickness of a curtain of more or less 15 centimeters. So, and according to requirements, we can install nowadays also covered by the norm, the new norm EN16034, fire curtains with overlapping systems. You might see here, we go for nearly 70 meter in one piece, 8.5 meter, and overlap it with more than 1.50 meter, just to separate this big opening. This big opening was necessary as trucks normally pass through. We had also, for sure, in metro systems, in the public sector, you have here an electrical cabinet. If it burns, it should be separated. So we placed completely around this stairway fire curtains, so that the fire will not go from out of this cabinet to the stair where the people should should emerge. It's the same here in our metro station, where we separate the stairway from the train tracks. It's here, you see here, the curtains are situated here. If a burning train is coming in, we have not so much heat development, more or less the smoke development is the important thing. And therefore we should keep the stair free from the smoke. And that's why we have to release these smoke curtains. This is a very special solution covering not all the norms, because we have a smoke-free layer of less than 2.50 meter. But this is an old metro station in Munich. And therefore we pointed on this side that it is completely closed, exit is closed, and only people from the other side who has to use this as emergency way can pass through. They have to bow up, but they can pass through. And we needed this curtain for the smoke separation to create a new section, as due to the architecture of a building, there was no mechanical exhausting system available, possible to install. This is a project my colleagues Omri and Nia has done in Israel. It's, you see here, we have an atrium, we have here a glass balustrade. You don't have to go completely down. We just have to create a smoke area here inside where the smoke is canalized up to a roof where it can be exhausted. Also, you can use with fire curtains for the outside use, for patios or courtyards, so that you avoid that from this level to this level, there might be a fire which overflashed. So it's, but always be aware, it's not you dedicated for shading. So you will see it and it will not work for a long time if you use it as a shading system, because this material is not dedicated to that. We have also this curtains with reducing of evaluation. Here you see the aluminum coating, which is more glimming. We closed it here to separate this stairway that people can emerge on this way. And for sure we can, but I don't like it, also horizontal systems. Because in horizontal systems, you very often have a problem. Where will you go with the smoke? And if you have a sprinkler, what will be with the load of a sprinkler here on the curtain? The system, it was during installation phase from a hotel. So it works perfectly in this way, but I don't like it so much. I prefer to close these areas here in this way, because when you can fight against the atrium or fight against directly on the floors. But it's depending on the fire concept, the fire designer who is doing that. And now, so I guess time is nearly over, isn't it? Yes, I have one of my highlights, and I would like to switch on the sound. No, what's good?
Okay.
So this is a bank building in Frankfurt, and you see here the flaps get open. We have here an opening of 28 meters by 19 meters. And we have here a triangle, which we have also to cover with fire curtain. And you see the flashlights now. And you see, for me, it was a technical, I was so surprised that we find a very good solution for that. We place here the sight guide. You see here the dimensions. We place here the sight guide for this fire curtain here and close this triangle area with fire curtain textile. So as this video is running, I just want to say thank you for all for your attention. I hope you can take something with you. I hope it was more or less clear. I hope my English was okay. And please send all your questions to Ranit and Omri, and we will answer on that. Thanks a lot. Okay, now it's up to you.
Thanks a lot, Thomas. אתם מוזמנים, אם אתם רוצים לפתוח מצלמות, ואם יש לכם שאלות, אז אתם מוזמנים עכשיו לשאול בצ'אט. אז אנחנו נחכה ככה איזה דקה, שתיים לשאלות שלכם, ואז נעשה איזה סשן של שאלות ותשובות.
טוב, בינתיים שאנחנו מחכים לשאלות ואנחנו רואים את הווילון יורד, רונית יכולה לפתוח לי גם מצלמה בבקשה? אנחנו רואים את הפרויקט
בהחלט.
המיוחדי הזה שהציג לנו תומאס. תומאס, I'm speaking about the nice curtain that we are seeing now. First I would like to thank Thomas for this lecture. I got all the time during the lecture, I got text messages from people that says it was an incredible lecture from the professional point of view, very professional, very good. You went deep to the details also, and it was very nice, and you shared a lot of your information with us and your experience. Ronit, are there any questions?
Yes, I sent you one question and there are some more.
Okay. Thomas, there is a question. How can we determine the height that the small curtains is going down from the ceiling?
Yeah, it's depending on the time of detection of fire itself, which system you have used. Are you linked directly to firefighters? And for sure, from goods you have installed inside of that, and when you go to the average design group and pick it up, and what you develop, how the fire is fast and strong and so on. As I mentioned in my scales before, in scale 3 or 4, something like that.
Okay.
It's always there are always a lot of assumptions you have to take, and it's always a game between opening of the exhausting space, how much you will spend, and how much place you have to let the curtains down. Sometimes you don't have the space which for closing it up to 2.5 meters. Sometimes it makes no sense. So you only go down for 1 meter, for 2 meters. So it's always depending on the situation of the building concept itself.
Okay. I see some questions. Some of them are questions that are less related to you and more related to the Israeli regulations. What is the safety measures that you take from that curtain can hurt people falling down on them? I know that you mentioned that, but I see the questions repeating.
Yes, the curtains are running down by a controlled speed. They are not motor driven. So they use the gravity failsafe principle. That means that they run only down by its own weight, which is blocked by the brake, which is inside of the motor to control the speed. It's a normative regulated brake, which has an official approval. And due to the weight of the system itself, it's always depending for sure of the width, not of the height so much, of a width. As you have only the weight of a bottom bar, which is roughly 4.5 kilograms per running meter, and the 400 grams per square meter fabric itself. That's the only weight which comes down. So it's not so a huge weight as which you are normally known from gates and doors. And also a big difference is that gates and doors are normally always motor driven. And they will not stop, or they might block, but only if we have someone touched. You can also secure the running down way by a security stripe, which is placed below the bottom profile, so that it, if the bottom profile touches someone, it stops. Maybe you can also organize that it runs down one turn, and after a decent time, it runs down again, or just stays in this position. This is all possible. It's only according to the controls.
Okay, thank you. One last question, because there are many, many questions, but most of the questions are really concerning the Israeli relations. So I want to ask you that.
Yes.
One question that I will ask you to answer shortly, because time is running out, and also we need to finish. What is the EI of the curtains? EI, what is the EI 30, EI 60? What isolation? What is the time of isolation that a small curtain can supply?
Yes, EI textile curtains, normally you know it out of the gates and doors business or facade business, also glass facades are classified with that. EI means that you have on one side the fire of 1,100 degree on the surface of the curtain, including the side guides and the housing and so on, you have a maximum temperature of 140 Kelvin. So that means you can pass by, you can install it in emergency ways, and the numbers behind EI30, that means it stands for 30 minutes. If you go for 60 minutes, it's EI60. For EI90, it goes for 90 minutes. This EI can also be achieved if you cool down the curtain, a standard curtain itself, that you bring enough water on it. We have done such a test. When you sprinkle the curtain on both sides, you get a maximum temperature on the surface of a curtain of 100 degrees. But these are very special solutions. The numbers behind the EI is only the minutes. It can stand it.
Okay. Okay. Thank you again.
Thanks a lot.